Hello and welcome to Amberger Smackdown. I'm your host, J. Christoph Amberger, and I am not the father of late Anna Nicole Smith's baby. I simply couldn't have been, because the only time I get out of the house for any stretch of time, I'm camping in remote wooded areas with my son's Boy Scout troop. And when you've tried sleeping outside in below freezing temperatures, the more certain you become about two inconvenient truths. First, that Anna Nicole, even in her prime, was an acquired taste. And second, that nature's ultimate aim is to kill you and kill you dead. That's just how it is. There's another, a third truth that you need to become aware of, especially if you're an investor. That is that the ultimate aim of the market is to separate you from your money. There are no two ways about it. Actually, there are always two ways about anything. In the cases of both nature and the markets, you have two choices you can make. In dealing with nature, you can eat right, exercise, occasionally check in with your favorite medicine man, wear wool out on the trail, and otherwise avoid rabid dogs, grazing buffalo, cuddly Kodiak bears, and hookers on Bourbon Street. Or you can wait for Congress to outlaw double bacon cheeseburgers. In dealing with the markets, there's plenty you can do to keep the market from chewing up your money. Identifying just how much you can truly afford to lose, and thus put at risk, is the first and most important step. Diversifying is just as important, so is having reason keep pace with your innate greed and the capacity to cut your losses. In fact, I think if everyone who's in the markets understood and applied the concept of a 20 or 30% trailing stop, you could commandeer the staff of the SEC to do foot patrols along the US-Canadian border, looking for lost urban hikers wearing sneakers and cotton socks and carrying Mountain Dew instead of a water bottle. But of course, in a culture that seems to let stay-at-home moms of four-year-olds dictate what we need to feel safe with, that would be just too easy. Luckily, we have elected officials who not only are eager to keep us from running with scissors, but also make sure that everybody's scissors are rounded, don't cut anything thicker than one sheet of paper at a time, and are made from non-toxic materials that conform to the Al Gore gold standard of hot air emissions. Take the Sarbanes-Oxley Act of 2002, the anti-fraud law passed after the Enron debacle. Its undoubtedly well-intended reams of red tape were supposed to keep accounting shenanigans from wiping out the pensions of people who had put all their eggs into one particular basket. But the resulting excessive regulation also has the unpleasant side effect that the U.S. is becoming an expensive and hence unattractive place to sell new stocks. Companies spent an estimated $6 billion in 2006 to comply with the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, according to a study by AMR Research. According to surveys by Financial Executives International, that works out to $4 million a year per company. Money those companies wouldn't have to spend if they went elsewhere. America's capital markets used to be the deepest, broadest, and most efficient in the world. Thanks to well-meaning bureaucrats, that's all changing. In fact, the U.S. stock markets are about to lose their competitive edge as the financial markets in Europe and Asia grow and mature. Since 2001, the U.S. share of worldwide securities industry revenues has fallen to about 58% from 62%. Now, I can hear you point out that U.S. financial firms have never been more profitable. Sure, they're global companies who don't really care where exactly a fee was generated, since they have their fingers in every pot, no matter where it is cooking. And cook they do. Morgan Stanley's European offices, for one, have seen revenues grow by about 40% a year. Too bad for us and the US Treasury that this is more than double the rate of their US operations. Already, initial public offerings are migrating to Hong Kong and London, where underwriters charge about half of what they do in the US. Most of last year's gargantuan Chinese and Russian IPOs went public not in New York, but in London, in Hong Kong, Shanghai. More than 350 companies went public in Europe, selling $86 billion worth of stock. In the US, only 235 companies raised just $48 billion. And not a single one of the 10 largest stock issues of 2006 was listed in New York. IPOs may well be the canary in the coal mine. When IPOs depart for greener pastures, trading, investment, and jobs will follow. Safety, especially the populist baloney that politicians try to sell us as safety, usually comes at a hefty price. Without risk, there may be no downside. But the upside certainly is very contained. That makes for great, if somewhat cookie-cutter, campaign speeches. But that's the fourth inconvenient truth I'll send you off with into what I hope will be another profitable week for you. In a global economy where the nod goes to whoever promises the highest margin, a welfare state focus on safety is a ticket to oblivion. Until next time, I'm J. Christoph Amberger for TaipanFinancialNews.com.